In the previous video, we are discussing about watershed management. Later, we had discussed about the techniques in which we could be able to intervene the flow of water. So in this video, we will see several methods in which we could be able to intervene the water in different methodology. Okay. So there are three categories that I made of how to intervene the flow of water. One was to intervene the flow of water when the water is flowing through the sloping surface of the ridged area, and then the intervention can be done in the drainage line. The third one is to intervene the flow of water in the farmland. So these are the broad three categories in which we could be able to stop the flow of water or reduce the flow of water and to maximize the duration in which the water flows in the gravity. Okay, so by doing this, we could be able to recharge more groundwater, and we can increase the storage of soil, and we could also make some arrangements which on the surface to store the water. So these are the benefits of watershed management we had discussed in the previous video itself. So in this video, we will be discussing some of the interventions along the ridge line and the drainage line also. Let us go with the first one, which is the intervention of flow of water on the slope line or the ridge area. Okay, now we had discussed in brief in the previous video itself, but I would like to go in detail in this video. So the first one is to create a protective layer by planting the trees, shrubs and grasses along the sloping length or the sloping area. Now you try to understand where such kind of protective cover can be established. Only when the percentage of slope is greater than 25%, we could go for this technique of applying the protective cover. But when the slope increases, we should go for another technique, which is called as trenches or counter trenches. Okay, as the name itself defines what is this is. Trench is simply the trench that is excavated, but this trench should be excavated along the counters. Then only it will be called as counter trenches. Now we will try to understand what are the advantages of the counter trenches, how it is located and what are the objectives. Okay, so you can see in the slide what are the figure of the counter trenches have been showed. There are two types of counter trenches. One is staggered counter trenches, the other one is continuous counter trenches. What we do is that we demarcate all the counter lines in the field. Then what we do is that either we dig the trenches along the counter lines at the regular intervals continuously, or we make the staggered portion of it. Okay, so as you can see in the image, you can see the staggered trenches that are excavated along the counter line. So both have its own advantages. We'll look into it later, but first we will discuss about the objectives. What are the basic objective of digging such kind of trenches? First is to stop the erosion of soil. The second is to reduce the velocity of the flow. Third is to retain the flow that is flowing towards the rest of the catchment area or the valley area. Now by doing this, we could be able to increase the capacity of water holding in the soil also. Okay, so now first thing is that we all know that the erosion is the greater problem in most of the watershed area. Because of excessive erosion, in future the velocity of the flow will also increase, right? So to arrest the flow of water, we should be able to dig these trenches. So basically, the water that is flowing on the surface, on the sloping surface, will fall into these trenches, and by falling into the trenches, it will reduce the velocity of the flow. Okay, so this is the basic method or the basic technique. So you don't need heavy engineering knowledge in order to make this. Only thing is that you should be able to establish or demarcate the counter lines. Once we demarcate the counter lines, we could be able to dig the trenches along it. Okay, next we will try to understand what are the locations in which we could be able to establish this counter trenches. The first thing is that basically the trenches are dug based on the slope itself. So as we had discussed earlier, if the slope is greater than 25%, we will not go for trenches because the slope is so high that the velocity is so high. Because of the higher slope, the velocity is also so high that it will carry most amount of soil material. So all the soil material that is carried away by the velocity of that nature will get stored into our trenches, and eventually the trenches becomes useless. So that's why we adopt the trenches when the percentage of slope is less than 25. Okay, the next thing is that what if the slope is less than 10%? So when it is less than 10%, we can take the advantage of lesser velocity by storing the water. So instead of counter trenches, we adopt the counterbunds. We will discuss the counterbunds in the next topic. So instead of when the slope is less than 10% and when the slope is greater than 25%, we are not going to adopt this counter trench. So we'll adopt the counter trenches in the range of slopes of 10% to 25% only. Now we'll try to understand how these counter trenches are located. What are the criteria on which the counter trenches are located? There are basically four criteria that you have to look into. One I already discussed, which is slope of the land. The second one is the quantum of rainfall that happens. If there is huge amount of water, the size of the trenches will also increase. If the rainfall is less, then the size of the trenches will also get reduced. Okay, so basically what you have to do is that you have to identify what is the amount of rainfall that happens in the region. Then you need to estimate how much is the quantum or the how much is the quantity of water that flows through that sloping area. So if we define this, we could be able to establish what are the size of trenches that are to be excavated. Next thing is to understand the permeability of the soil. So if the soil is highly permeable, more water will be stored in the soil. If the soil is less permeable, less amount of water will be stored in the soil. Because of that, if the soil goes on to be impermeable, so what happens is the erosion will increase and the velocity will increase. So basically the soil also plays a predominant role in defining what should be the size of trenches. Next, I have already discussed about the slope of the land. More the slope, greater the velocity, higher the erosion, and lesser the benefit of our trenches. Next, the last one is the vegetative cover. We all know if the vegetative cover increases, the velocity of flow reduces. If the vegetative cover decreases, the velocity of flow increases. So other than this, you must be also look into the soil that has been dug from the trench. Okay, so we all know when the soil is disturbed in nature, it is susceptible for more erosion. Okay, so all the soil that is dug out from the trenches should be laid in such a manner that it will not get eroded, first thing. Second thing, what we could do is that we can plant some of the grass or shrubs over the soil that has been dug and placed at the top of the soil. Okay, so we must take care of that too. So the next technique is to construct the counterbunds. Counterbunds are similar to that of counter trenches. In counter trenches, what we used to do is that we used to dug the trenches along the counter lines, then we used to leave it as it is. Okay, now what we do is wherever we have dug upstream of that trench, we construct a bund. So there are two things that we are taking advantage. We are storing the water within the trench at the same time by reducing the velocity, and also the water that is being reduced, the velocity of the water which has been reduced, is also made to stop by the bund which has been constructed. So this is the advantage of going for counterbund. But there are several disadvantages associated with the counterbund. Like, try to imagine this, we need to find out the soil that is to be constructed for bund from the regional itself. So if the soil is not of engineering quality, like for example, if it doesn't have a shear strength, if it doesn't have a stability, over the time the counter bund will be breached by the flow of water. If the velocity is increasing, so what happens is that the bund will get collapsed, or it can be breached by the high velocity flow of water. Now the second thing that you could be even observe is that the animals that travel across this ridge line may also damage the counterbunds. Eventually in rainy season, the counterbunds might be breached, and because of that, the entire erosion of soil may also increase. So these are the two things that we have to note down when we are going to construct for counterbunds. Next is that how do we locate the counterbunds? As I already explained you, if the slope is greater than 10%, we go for counter trenches. When the slope gets less than 10%, we know that the velocity of the flow is very less. So we'll take the advantage of that to store more water within the bund. So when the slope is less than 10%, we go for counter bund. So let us discuss about the interventions that are made along the drainage line. We had also already discussed in brief about the interventions that are made in the previous video. Now we will directly look into the different structures that are constructed across the stream line to arrest the flow of water. Okay, so I'll briefly explain you under different categories these structures are constructed. When the bed slope is greater than 20%, we use raw materials that are available to arrest the flow of water by constructing the obstruction to it. Okay, then when the bed slopes is between 5 to 20%, we go for loose boulder checks or boulder cum earth checks. When bed slopes are less than 5%, we can adopt for water arresting structures like earthen bund, sand fill dams and gabion structure. Now let us discuss the loose boulder checks. Loose boulder checks are basically constructed for a catchment of 50 hectares. Loose boulder checks are constructed from the boulders that are available in the premise. There are four objectives of loose boulder checks that are constructed across the stream. First is to stop the erosion of flow or to reduce the erosion of soil. The next thing is to reduce the velocity of the flow that is flowing in the downstream side, and by doing that we could be able to trap the silt that is being carried away through the flowing water. The third thing is to increase the hydraulic head. So as we know that when the heap of boulders are placed, so the hydraulic head increases. Hydraulic head is nothing but the depth of water that is being retained. Okay, so by increasing that depth of water, there is a hydrostatic pressure that is created. From that the water can seep into the soil and it can even increase the groundwater. Next and the last one is to increase the duration of flow of water to the water harvesting structure. So basically what happens is the entire watershed is divided into several micro catchments and milli catchment areas based on the area. Like for example, if it is milli catchment, I already discussed what is the area, and if it is micro catchment, I have already explained to you what will be the area of that shed. So these micro and milli watersheds are divided into several parts, and across all those milli watersheds these boulder checks are created. So boulder checks basically arrest some amount of water and it will delay the flow of water to the water harvesting structure, which is earthen dam, which is major dam. So by doing this we are increasing the time of flow of water into the harvesting structure. So that is the fourth advantage or the objective of constructing the boulder checks. So now let us look into the condition where we are going to select the location of the boulder checks. First, we know that the boulder checks should not be having a catchment area of greater than 1 to 2 hectares. The boulder check should be less than the 20% of the slope. Boulder check should be constructed at a slope less than 20%. Boulder check should be constructed in at a position where the boulders are easily available. The third thing is that we should look into the kind of embankments that we have. So the embankment should be strong enough to hold the loose boulders and to resist the flow of water in the downstream side. So in the last point, we could be able to say that our loose boulder checks do not have a priority to store the water, but some importance should be given to store the water or to at least pound the water for some time so that it can recharge the groundwater. Let us look into the next technique of intermingling the flow of water in the drainage line, that is gabion structure. Gabion structures are constructed by the locally available rock and stone material. Gabion structures are constructed across a stream which is having catchment area of 50 to 500 hectares. The objectives of the gabion structure remain same as that of the loose boulder checks, that is to reduce the soil erosion, to trap the silt and to increase the groundwater recharge, and the fourth objective, that is to increase the duration in which the water flows towards the water harvesting structures. The next thing is we look into the location where the gabion structures are constructed. To construct a gabion structure, we must look into three aspects. One is the embankment. We need to see whether the embankments are strong enough to hold the gabion structure. The second thing is the type of material that is available within the premise of gabion structure. The third thing is to observe the bed slope of the gabion structure. Greater the bed slope, lesser the storage of water and greater the chances of breaching the gabion structure too. Gabion structures are usually overflow kind of structures. You can see in the picture also that the water is flowing from the top of the weir or the crust. The third aspect for selecting the site for gabion structure is the kind of material that is available at the bed of the gabion structure. If the material is impermeable in nature, lesser the groundwater will be recharged. If it is permeable in nature, more the groundwater will be recharged. You can see in the picture the components of gabion structure. There is a foundation trench, over that we'll keep the apron. Aprons are basically the protective covers that are constructed on the upstream and downstream of the bed. Then we have side walls, the side walls, and then we have head walls extension. So basically the egg wall extensions are embedded within the embankments to create the stiffness for the gabion structure. Okay, so this is what the gabion structure is.